10.
It's a kid. Oh, God, it's a kid.
What did he say?
10.
9.
This countdown is giving me time.
Jesus.
It's a fake, but how can I prove it? How? How?
8.
This kid will die. Tell me why the painting is a fake. Tell me!
7.
No, shut up. Don't say anything. Only works if I figure it out.
Must be possible. Must be staring me in the face.
6.
What did you do that?
How?
5.
Speed enough.
Shut up. Oh!
Here's the famous detective Sherlock Holmes in action. In this clip, he has to prove that a painting is fake in only 10 seconds. If he doesn't do it, a kid will die. Let's watch the rest.
The Van Buren supernova.
Please, there's somebody there. Somebody help me.
There you go. Go find out where he is and pick him up. Van Buren supernova, so-called. Exploding star only appeared in the sky in 1858.
So how could it have been painted in the 1640s? Oh.
Incredible, isn't it? By the way, you can say so-called to refer to the way something or someone is usually called or known for. In this case, the Van Buren supernova is usually called the exploding star. You can also say AKA, which means also known as. So we could say the Van Buren supernova, AKA the exploding star. Keep watching to learn more vocabulary, pronunciation, and a bit of British English. In the end, you will test your listening skills by watching the scenes again without subtitles to see how much you understand. But before we get started, make sure you hit that subscribe button and bell down below, because every week we put out new lessons like this to help you understand your favorite movies and TV series without getting lost, without missing the jokes, and without subtitles. So hit that subscribe button and bell down below in order not to miss a single new lesson.
The game was too elaborate. You're enjoying yourself too much.
No such thing as too much.
Oh, enjoying the thrill of the chase is fine. Craving the distraction of the game, I sympathize entirely, but sentiment. Sentiment is a chemical defect found in the losing side.
Sentiment? What are you talking about?
You.
Oh, dear God. Look at the poor man. You don't actually think I was interested in you. Why? Because you're the great Sherlock Holmes, the clever detective in the funny hat.
No. Because I took your pulse. Elevated. Your pupils dilated. The game was too elaborate. You're enjoying yourself too much.
No such thing as too much.
Something elaborate is complex, difficult, full of details. But you can also use the word elaborate as a verb. For example, if I ask you, hey, can you please elaborate? Or you care to elaborate on that? I'm asking you to explain in more detail something you said earlier. Check out this example.
You care to elaborate?
It's not in my interest for Hector Salamanca to die at this time.
No such thing as too much.
Oh, enjoying the thrill of the chase is fine.
In this context here, the thrill is the excitement, okay? The excitement of the chase. And to chase means to pursue or go after something or someone. Imagine, for example, the police that chases the thieves or the criminals. They go after them. That's the meaning of chase here. So the phrase, the thrill of the chase, means the excitement of the chase, all right? Let's watch another clip from Sherlock where the same phrase is used.
London is in danger, John. There's an imminent terrorist attack and I need your help.
My help?
You have missed this. Admit it. The thrill of the chase, the blood pumping through your veins, just the two of us against the rest of the world. Craving the distraction of the game, I sympathize entirely, but sentiment.
When you crave something, you have a strong desire for it. We call it a craving. For example, after lunch, I always crave a piece of chocolate. You see, it's that strong desire to have that piece of chocolate after lunch. Now, the game. We can understand the game as maybe a mystery or a case that a detective or private investigator has to work on. All right?
Craving the distraction of the game, I sympathize entirely with sentiment.
This is typical from British English. In American English, people would probably write this word I-Z-E at the end. Sympathize with a Z at the end, not with an S. That's more typical of American English. All right? Let me give you some other examples. Here it is. Realize, realize. Apologize, apologize. Organize, organize. So pay attention to that detail. Remember that detail. This ending with Z, American English. This ending with S, British English.
You don't actually think I was interested in you.
This combination is important that you memorize. We usually say interested in, okay? We use the preposition in after interested. Sometimes, you know, prepositions don't make any sense, so it's just easier for you to memorize them. Like in this case. Just memorize that it's always interested in. Let me give you some examples. Interested in playing, interested in doing. Also, we have a nice grammar rule here, which is the case of a preposition and a verb right after. Did you hear my examples? Interested in playing. In is a preposition. Playing is a verb. But notice that I use the verb in the ing form. That's another common grammar rule. After prepositions, if you have a verb, make sure the verb is in the ing form. That's why we say interested in playing, interested in doing, interested in working. Let me give you some more examples that I have here. I've been thinking about traveling abroad. In order to get that promotion, I need to keep on learning. He's really good at building houses. I always wash my face after waking up. Before working as a writer, she used to be a lawyer.
No. Because I took your pulse.
Your pulse is basically your heartbeat. It's usually felt in your neck or wrist. Usually the pulse is checked to see if a person is dead or not. Here's an example.
The man's in shock. He may need a few moments. The witness stated that he saw Lord Blackwood rise from the grave. Well?
Well?
You pronounced him dead. He had no pulse.
Elevated. Your pupils dilated.
Your pupil is that circular black area in the center of your eye. When something dilates, it becomes wider or more open. But the word pupil also means student or learner. For example, he was my star pupil when I taught him. Now here's a pronunciation mini lesson for you. Let's talk about the letter R a little bit. This is one of the main differences in pronunciation between British English and American English. The way the letter R after vowels is pronounced. Usually in British English, the tendency is not to pronounce that R after vowels. In American English, we will go R, you know, that sound, the R sound. Here are some examples. I'm gonna try to do my best and emulate a British pronunciation here, just for illustration purposes, okay? So in British English, we would say dear. Dear, you see? Dear, dear. And then poor, poor. Your, your. Sherlock, sure. Can you hear it? Sherlock, Sherlock. Clever. Clever. But now, let's listen to these words again in the clip. They are all pronounced with a British pronunciation, and pay attention to how the letter R sounds, or doesn't sound in this case, in those clips. Here it is.
Oh dear God, look at the poor man.
Why? Because you're the great Sherlock Holmes, the clever detective in the funny hat.
No.
You know, all this talk about British English and American English actually reminds me of that funny clip from Friends where Ross, a university professor, then fakes a British accent in order to come across as more respectful or to show more authority as a professor. It's really funny. Here it is.
Right. So when Rigby got his samples back from the laboratory, he made a startling discovery. What he believed to be igneous was in fact sedimentary. Imagine his consternation when... Oh, bloody hell.
If you're like most learners, then you probably get frustrated when you learn maybe a pronunciation sound, let's say the American and the British R, but then when it's time for you to speak in the real world, you completely forget it. It can be quite frustrating, I know. Now, I found that one of the best solutions to this is to, after I learn a new word or sound, to use it as soon as possible. But what happens if you simply don't have somebody else to practice speaking English with? Well, that's exactly why we created the Real Life app, which is the only place where anytime, anywhere, you can press a button and instantly connect to another English speaker in another part of the world to have a conversation and speak together. And maybe even practice all these new expressions and pronunciation sounds that you're learning in today's lesson. And on the app, you can also listen to the Real Life English podcast lessons with Ethan and myself. And we give you transcripts and vocabulary flashcards to help you understand and learn more with each new episode. By the way, the app is free, and you can download it right now to see it for yourself. But first, let me show you what one of our app users, Shirley, has to say about her experience using the Real Life app. The Real Life app is a groundbreaking app for English learners because we can practice many abilities in one place. While we're listening to a podcast, we can read following the transcript and then practice the vocabulary through flashcards. Personally, flashcards are the best thing since sliced bread. I recall words faster while I'm speaking, not to mention I have a better understanding while I'm reading, listening, and watching. On top of all that, we can sharpen our speaking skills by talking to people around the globe. It's simply fascinating. So if you want to go from feeling like a lost, insecure English learner to becoming a confident, natural English speaker, make sure you download the Real Life app right now for free and try it out. You can click up here or down in the description below, or you can also go to Google Play Store or Apple App Store, search for Real Life English and download the app from there. All right? Now let's get back to the lesson with Sherlock.
I imagine John Watson thinks love's a mystery to me, but the chemistry is incredibly simple and very destructive. When we first met, you told me the disguise is always a self-portrait. How true of you, the combination to your safe, your measurements. But this is far more intimate. This is your heart, and you should never let it rule your head. I've always assumed that love is a dangerous disadvantage. Thank you for the final proof.
Everything I said, it's not real. I was just playing the game.
I know. And this is just losing. I imagine John Watson thinks love's a mystery to me, but the chemistry is incredibly simple and very destructive.
Did you know that you can express your opinion simply by adding one word to your sentences? Yes, it's true. And you can do that with adverbs. There are certain adverbs that you can use before the adjective or before the verb in order to express how you feel about something. And also, you are giving more information. Look at this example in the clip. Sherlock says, "The chemistry is incredibly simple." He could have said simply, "The chemistry is simple." But no, he wants to express something else. He wants to express the idea that it's incredibly simple. It's like super simple. That's why he uses the adverb incredibly here. Here are more examples. The movie was surprisingly funny. You see, the movie was surprisingly funny. I could simply say the movie was funny. But that's pretty much it. But if I say the movie was surprisingly funny, now I'm giving you two pieces of information. Yes, the movie was funny. And also, I was surprised. I felt surprised that the movie was funny. Got it?
When we first met, you told me the disguise is always a self-portrait. How true of you, the combination to your safe, your measurements.
A disguise is something you wear or do in order to hide your true identity. This is something very common to see in detective shows, such as Sherlock. Here's another example from the series where Sherlock is talking about the art of disguise.
How did you get in?
Please.
I want to know.
The art of disguise is knowing how to hide in plain sight.
Who are you?
Sherlock Holmes.
A portrait is a painting, photo, or drawing of a person. Self-portrait is an image of yourself, either as a painting, a photo, or drawing. So in this case here, in the phrase, disguise is always a self-portrait, Irene means that your disguise will always be a small part of you.
When we first met, you told me the disguise is always a self-portrait. How true of you, the combination to your safe, your measurements.
A safe is a strong box or cabinet with special locks for you to keep valuable things. It usually has a combination of numbers to open it. Your measurements are the numbers used to describe the size and shape of your body. For example, your waist, your hip, or your bust. Now, this is interesting because in the clip here, we learn that the combination of Irene's safe is something personal of hers, her body measurements. Remember that earlier she says to Sherlock that disguise is always a self-portrait. That's what she means. She hides her true identity with information that is typical of her or personal to her, such as her body measurements. Speaking of which, let's watch the clip when Sherlock opens Irene's safe. It's really cool.
Thank you, Mr. Holmes. Open it, please.
Vatican cameos.
You should never let it rule your head.
All right, so now Sherlock is teaching Irene a lesson because he says, this is your heart and you should never let it rule your head. In other words, you should never let your emotions control your head or control your decisions. I think he says this to her here because watching the clip, we understand that she starts to have feelings for Sherlock to the point that she even uses Sherlock's name as the passcode or password on her phone. So Sherlock is kind of criticizing her in that sense and saying, hey, this is you basically letting your emotions get the best of you or make your decisions for you. So this is your heart and you should never let it rule your head.
I've always assumed that love is a dangerous disadvantage.
All right, so more pronunciation. First of all, did you hear how Sherlock says the word assume? He doesn't say assume, he goes assume. So there is this U sound there in the middle, assume. In American English, we would typically say assume. And here's another difference in pronunciation between British English and American English, the letter A. In some regions of England, usually this A here has this sound. So, for example, we hear Sherlock saying disadvantage, disadvan, van, you see, on, disadvantage. An American would typically say disadvan, vantage, disadvantage, or disadvantage. Some more examples, we have after, after, versus after in American English. Class, class, you see the A there? Ah, class, versus class. Path, versus path. And finally, bath, versus bath. All right, so now it's the moment of truth. Can you understand the scenes without subtitles? Let's watch and see.
The game was too elaborate. You're enjoying yourself too much.
No such thing as too much.
Oh, enjoying the thrill of the chase is fine. Craving the distraction of the game, I sympathize entirely, but sentiment. Sentiment is a chemical defect found in the losing side.
Sentiment? What are you talking about?
You.
Oh, dear God. Look at the poor man.
Which option below best replaces the line, the thrill, the absurdity, the excitement, the violence?
You don't actually think I was interested in you. Why? Because you're the great Sherlock Holmes, the clever detective in the funny hat.
No. Because I took your pulse.
Choose the correct option. I was interested to go to university next year, but I gave up. I was interested about going to university next year, but I gave up. I was interested in going to university next year, but I gave up.
Imagine John Watson thinks love's a mystery to me, but the chemistry is incredibly simple and very destructive. When we first met, you told me that disguise is always a self-portrait. How true of you, the combination to your safe, your measurements. But this is far more intimate. This is your heart, and you should never let it rule your head. I've always assumed that love is a dangerous disadvantage. Thank you for the final proof.
Everything I said, it's not real. I was just playing the game.
I know. And this is just losing.
Complete the gaps with the correct form of the word in parentheses. I cried when the main character was killed in the series. The movie was funny. Alright, awesome! So now it's time for the comment of the day. And the comment of the day comes from the lesson Learn English with Podcasts, Jesse Pinkman, that we have posted recently here on the channel. Alexander says, thanks for your tremendous help. Could you explain the difference between if you heat butter, it melts, and if you heat butter, it will melt? If you don't mind. Sure, Alexander, I don't mind. So, these examples here are conditionals, okay? The first example, if you heat butter, it melts. This is what we call zero conditional. We form it by using if in present tense. If you heat butter, you see heat is in the present tense. And then the second clause or the second part of the phrase is also in the present tense. It melts, okay? So if present, present, that's the structure. The zero conditional is usually used for facts, scientific facts or things that are always true. But now I want to hear from you guys. What have you learned in today's lesson? Any questions? Any comments? Any doubts? Let me know in the comment section below. I'm curious to know. Great job. You have made it until the end of the lesson. You rock. Don't forget to like this video. Share this video with a friend who's also learning English and who is a Sherlock fan. And subscribe to the channel in case you're not subscribed yet. If you want to keep learning English while having a ton of fun, you might want to check out this next lesson. Here it is. Yeah, so this is what I would do if I had this clip here now in front of me.
You should know I'm waiting for someone.
Oh yeah, who's the lucky guy? Or girl?
What does it matter to you?
Didn't mean to interrupt.
You're not.
Okay, cool. So here in the situation, we can see a boy and Wednesday, the main character, the female protagonist. And there seems to be a little tension between them. Because, you know, if you know the show is about teenagers or pre-teenagers, you know, going to a special school for kids who have powers.